Hey everyone, this is Chris from Echobind, and I'm going to be talking today about supercharging your tests with factories. So it turns out that automated tests really love factories, and factories really love Prisma. So to kind of highlight why, I'm going to go over a few different things. The first being request tests, which you might also know as integration tests. And then we're going to be talking about resetting the database, making sure you're creating valid data in your tests. We'll touch on the factory pattern and how it relates to Prisma. Then we'll talk a little bit about end-to-end tests and how you can use those same patterns. Finally, we'll have some tips and tricks that I've picked up along the way doing this. So to start, let's talk through some of our testing types. Unit tests are great. They're important. Please write them. We are not going to be talking about that. That's all I have to say there. So in this request test, again, these can often be called integration tests. Really what I like to think of is almost like sort of like an end-to-end test, but for the API layer only. And the important part about integration tests or request tests is that you're actually using a live database. That's the important piece. So you're not mocking things out. You're actually using live data, test data. So, basically I like to call them request tests because it's better in my head to say, hey, this is making a request and we are getting a response back. And what these are really, really good for is to test kind of permissions and edge cases, you know, make sure that a user can't call things only an admin should be able to. I can't go delete posts that you create, little things like that. So here's an example of what one looks like. And we'll go over all of these pieces. This is going to be a GraphQL example, but essentially just looking at, we're going to make the request and assert a response. So first, I want to touch on these top two items. And I don't want to go too in-depth on this, but essentially when you're doing this type of testing and you have a live database, you want to make sure that you reset your data between each test. So that's why we have a before each here with reset DB. So that's just a helper. You could use in that helper something like Prisma migrate reset. That would work. It's going to be a lot slower. So the best thing to do is do a truncate on your data so that every single test starts with no records in the database. It's a known state. That's really important. There's some great docs that the Prisma team has that sort of outline some of that for you. So the other piece here is after each, we want to just make sure that the database is fully disconnected so that we don't have any stray connections laying around. This is also pretty important. The final thing on this is that, using Jest, you want to make sure to use the run in band option for these types of tests. And what really that means is Jest does parallel test runs by default. We do not want that in this case because we're sort of looking at the same database across multiple tests and it's reset, but it doesn't help you if multiple things are writing to it. So those are important. And so now let's dive into the actual test. Here's the query that we're doing. So we're just checking that this mutation can be called, but there's no logged in user here. So it's just a mutation and we're going to get back some errors from the API. So in this case, we have a not authorized error is kind of the main thing that we're looking at. And you might notice I used inline snapshots there. So I actually think inline snapshots are really, really great so long as you use them properly. I like to use them to test the error responses and just basically assert that they're as I expect versus having to write them all out. So this example, you might not really understand the importance of that. It might not make a lot of sense. You could say, well, I can just write that as a normal Jest assertion, and you could. But when you have something that's a little bit more like this, this is where it's nice because then you have not only an array of errors and you can say, hey, I got back four items, but this is the text that's there. And anytime that changes within your app, you will be asked to update the snapshot. So they're good for that. Again, I use them for these error states pretty much only, but they're really good for that. So just make sure you don't abuse them. Next, we need to make sure we create valid data in our tests. And so we're going to look at one now where a user actually has to be logged in. So in this case, you can see that we are going to make a GraphQL request as a user. We need to create valid user data here. So to do that, we can just reach for Prisma and use Prisma's user.create and create the data we want, including things like hashing a password. So that's really nice. And we can actually not only do that, but we can create related data too. So if I have a profile for this user that I need to create, that's pretty easily done with all the nice functions that Prisma gives us. So that's just a quickly request, test, integration tests in a nutshell. So just make the request as a user or a guest and assert the response, create proper data for the test and nothing more, and make sure you're resetting this database. You'll find that doing these gives you a really great amount of test coverage pretty quickly. So to see how we can make this better, we're going to talk through the factory pattern. So what are factories? I kind of view them as these simple object makers. You say, hey, create me or build me an object that has these attributes. And what's interesting is you don't want to worry about the required attributes for these. We actually want to lean on the factory to give us the defaults for the required attributes. And you'll see why here in a second. So here's kind of what this looks like. We have a user factory that we're using that's creating things for us. And then we also have an organization factory. We're using these two together with a few different functions. So this looks really, really interesting. So to dive in a little bit further, you might notice that this looks an awful lot like a Prisma create call. And it does, because that's what we're actually calling under the hood. But what's important here is you can see here, I'm not passing an email on this top line. That's a required attribute for the database in a certain format, but I can override it here. And same thing for an organization. I'm saying, create me an organization, just go build it. I don't have to worry about passing all the default attributes every single time. And then on this last line, it's something more like, we're creating an organization, we're connecting to an existing user that we created above, but then we're also creating a new one. So this gets really, really powerful. And this is an example of how you might go create a factory in your app. So again, it's going to be just an object that returns a build and create function. And we're going to use those to build all of our objects up in the database. So if we look at the create part first, you can see that we're just calling prisma.organizationCreate in this example. And we're telling it to use the build function that's above in order to build the proper data. And so in this case, I have a slug and a name attribute. These are both required for the database. So that's why I'm defining them in the factory. And that's also why they are using these sort of dynamic attributes as defaults, because you want in a test to be able to create multiple organizations and not worry about unique constraints and issues that you'll run into that way. So that's really helpful. And that's honestly all you need to get started with it. But then we can take it a step further. So in this example, we're actually using TypeScript and we're pulling in the types that Prisma gives us for this organization create input. So this type's generated when you generate your Prisma client and you can pull that in and use it. So what we're also doing is using a fake library called chance that's allowing us to specify a word, a company. It'll automatically create a bunch of stuff that's randomized, but kind of related to that function that we're calling. And then we're just passing it through. The other thing that I added here is automatically including things. And so if you are passing in connect or create, like we saw on that previous slide, it's automatically going to add the include clause for you so that you don't have to worry about it. And so again, looking at that, let's figure out a way to make that a little bit more simple. And so this example takes all of the code that was here, and you might think about the fact if you have multiple versions of this, so you have an organization and you have a user, the code's going to look pretty similar. You're going to have a build, create, that build, the include, that's all going to be kind of the same. So this is a way to make it a little bit cleaner. You could extract a create factory function, and we'll come back to this type in a second. But the main point here is that you're telling the Prisma model that you want to use, in this case, organization, and you're giving it default attributes. And so you might call this required attributes. This is the current pattern that we've been using on a lot of apps at Echobyne. And it's been pretty nice because, you know, I want to make it so that this TypeScript attribute, again, that I had showed before, instead of being passed in manually, is kind of inferred from this Prisma model. That would be ideal. We're not quite there yet. We need to figure some stuff out. But at its heart, these 12 lines or so, this is what your factory definitions could look like in the app, provided that you have this create factory function. So you could go in and say the organization factory and a user factory and all these other ones that you might need throughout your app. This is pretty much the definition, and it's a pretty easy pattern to follow. And by the way, if you're ever extracting a library out from a code base, this is a really good pattern to follow, to where you just put it in lib, get it working, and then later extract it to an actual package. Okay, so again, those are the benefits we get mainly just due to the power of Prisma. And that's really, really great for us. So why might you want to use factories in this way? What's another reason outside of just not worrying about the default attributes? This is related to default attributes because let's say you go in and add a new one on a user called phone, and phone is now required. You, instead of searching across your entire test suite, trying to find every time you create a user and adding phone to that, we're here just going to update the factory and say, oh, phone is a required attribute for us. It's going to be in this type of format. We can use this kind of faker library to make it a little bit nicer if we want to and randomize it. But that's it. You just update it in one spot. So that's really nice. So factories, in a nutshell, again, are creating an object, at least as it relates to testing in factories, creating an object that exports a build and create function. It's going to use those to build everything for you, adding defaults for required attributes, and then ideally using a faker library like chance to help with generating random values. So next, I want to talk a little bit about end-to-end tests and how they can you can do the same kind of pattern there. This is where the fake library stuff is really helpful, in my opinion. So these are at the front-end layer of the code, and it's using something like Cypress as a runner. This is running into a real browser and then eventually using your front-end code to call the API and get responses back and render on the screen. So you might think, well, there's a little bit of overlap here between these requests or integration tests and these end-to-end tests, and that's true. But as long as you have a strategy to use them together, it's actually fine. So for us, what we do is, like I said, request tests for testing kind of edge cases and API business logic, still using a live database. End-to-end, it's really great to focus on critical software paths. And so those are things like logging in, creating an account, purchasing something, things like that. And then when you're creating features, make the end-to-end tests more of the happy path and maybe one error message case, but then test all of the other miscellaneous things or users trying to be bad and that kind of thing in the request tests. So that's how we use them. To demonstrate how it's used, we're going to look at some examples using Cypress. So these are pretty much the same idea and the same pattern I just talked about. Here's what it would look like. So there's a couple things in Cypress that make this a little bit annoying. The first being you cannot use async await. And so you might notice that we're using promises and saying dot then in the code. And then so we're setting something up and then running our normal testing. It's kind of annoying, but it's not the worst thing in the world. The second is that you can't call node code directly in a Cypress test because it runs in a browser environment. And so to get around that, you need to use tasks in Cypress, which allow you to use node code. So we set up a task called factory. And in this case, the pattern we decided on was using, you know, the name of the actual factory we care about, and then the attributes that we're going to build with. So very similar to how you used it in the previous type of tests. Very similar idea. And when you go to see how this is actually implemented in Cypress, we want to kind of share as much of our code as we can. And so to start, we're going to basically do this before run, make sure the database is in a good spot. And then these tasks are very similar to the others that I showed. We need to make sure we can reset a database for between each test. We need to make sure we can disconnect a database. And then this is that factory function. And the factory function, again, in this case, we decided just to look it up via name. We're just importing the factories in our app and leverage it in this way. So that's pretty much all you need to kind of hook it together. There is this extra step, again, because of the way node code works there, but that's just what it is. But otherwise, the way that you think about it and the way that you write it is identical. Let's talk about a few tips and tricks. So there's not a lot, but I just wanted to highlight a couple things here as you're thinking through some of this. The first would be, don't put relationships in your factory functions. It can be very tempting to say, give me a user with posts that has comments. If you do that, you're going to be creating records you might not need. So I really encourage you just to pass in all the relationships using Prisma's create and connect methods. It's nice. It's right in the test. It makes it very straightforward which records are created for that test. We talked about leveraging fake data to find some edge cases. because using known quantities all the time can really create bugs. And so you want to use the functions provided by chance or your fake library. And then the final piece is to randomize your enum values so that you can have an active status or inactive status, and you randomize these values in your tests using something like pick one. So finally, with all of this, I'd just like to say that tests love factories, factories love Prisma. If you're interested in this type of thing and you want to help out with it, we have a discussion going on the Echobind GitHub for Prisma Factory. It's just discussions right now. And maybe by the time you watch this, there might be an actual library. And if you're interested in these kind of patterns and more, we've got a default web template that we use that has a lot of this type of stuff. So thanks so much, everybody. Thanks to Prisma for having me. And I hope you learned some stuff in this talk. If there's any questions that you all have, please reach out. That's my Twitter. Talk to you soon.